Welcome to Professional Geek Podcast, an interview podcast. I'm your host, Blaire Knight Graves, and my co-host is Mark Beers.
You can find us on Twitter, at Mark Beers, or at Blaire Loves TV. And remember, kids, that's Blaire with an E.
You can also follow this podcast Twitter handle, at ProGeek Podcast.
Episode 21, Emily Graslie. Our guest this week is Emily Graslie. Emily is the Field Museum's Chief Curiosity Correspondent and host of the educational YouTube channel, The Brain Scoop. As host of The Brain Scoop, Emily brings an infectious enthusiasm as she shares the work that goes on behind the scenes at the Field Museum and introduces us to the men and women behind the study of the natural world. Emily, I really want to thank you for joining us on the show this evening. Now, I do have to confess that you were suggested as a possible interview by our blog manager, Zach Weiss. And before that, I was not familiar with your work, but I'm really glad that he did suggest that we reach out and chat with you, because I've been so very thoroughly entertained by the Brain Scoop over the last few days. And I'm really excited to get the chance to introduce you to our audience. So to kind of start things off here, let's kind of give our audience a little bit of a sense of what you do. Now, you're the Chief Curiosity Correspondent at the Field Museum. What exactly does that mean?
Yeah, thanks for having me on the show. And as far as my job goes, so kind of have a novel job title, which I'm quite proud of. But my primary function at the Field Museum as their Chief Curiosity Correspondent is that I'm the creator, host, writer, and producer of an educational YouTube channel called The Brain Scoop. And our show is a biweekly program. Now we publish a video about every other week on our show. And we just explore every facet and aspect of what happens behind the scenes of a natural history museum. And it's really fun, because one thing that we like to remind visitors and viewers of our program is that if you go to a place like the Field Museum in Chicago, it's a huge institution with many, many exhibition halls and more than you can probably see in a single day. But what's on display is really only less than 1% of everything that's in the collections of a natural history museum. We have 99% more stuff behind the scenes that's being actively worked on by researchers not only in Chicago, but who come in from all over the world. And so the Brain Scoop was really kind of a solution to this problem of how do we get this all out to the public in a way that's accessible and fun and engaging. And so that's kind of the impetus for the Brain Scoop.
Interesting. Now, as you are, obviously, if you've not been to Chicago, the Field Museum is gigantic. And so, like, do you just kind of, you say you produce a video bi-weekly. So that, in the other times where you're not producing or writing a video, are you just kind of wandering around the Field Museum, getting lost and hoping to find awesome things to talk about? Or how do you determine what things that you decide to focus on an individual episode?
Well, sometimes, but I do spend a lot of time actually talking with our scientists. The field has, about 150, 200 scientists who are either local or visiting, and I spend a lot of time interacting with them and kind of getting a sense of not only what's happening in the scientific community in Chicago, but in their individual communities. So, I'll go meet with somebody who studies birds and ask them what's the big hot thing in the field of ornithology, or I'll talk to our scientists who study fishes and ask them, what people are looking at now today in this day and age, working in museum collections and with museum specimens. But I also spend a lot of time doing public presentations. So I do a lot of public speaking. I do a lot of things on social media. I talk to a lot of people, the press, do podcasts, a lot of public facing stuff, just like advocating for museum collections. But kind of in terms of like how we get ideas for the program, it can be from a hallway conversation with somebody like, hey, what are you working on? And usually the funny thing about scientists is that they don't think of themselves as like the coolest people ever. And I do. You'll get like this blasé response. They're like, oh, not much. I just, I'm going to submit a paper where I describe 5 new species of Permian, synapsids, these proto mammals. And you're like, wait, what? like, wait, what's going on right now in this conversation? And so a lot of times, like, I get ideas from that. And sometimes I get ideas because there's like a seed that's planted and it'll take a couple of years for that idea to come to fruition. So we're always kind of playing this back and forth game of what's happening right now and like what's something that we can plan for to talk about in the future.
So that's, you know, very much, that's so exciting that you get to do that on a day-to-day basis now. But I want to talk to you a little bit about your past and where this came from. You graduated from college with an art degree, from what I understand, this path into science sort of happened by accident for you. How did being an art school student lead to preparing lab specimens on YouTube and interviewing scientists around the country?
Well, that's a great question. So when I was an art major, what I was focusing on was landscape painting. I just love landscapes. I always have. And I'm from South Dakota and then did my art degree at the University of Montana in Missoula. So I've been privileged to like be surrounded by natural beauty my entire life. And I always wanted to capture what that was like to live in a place that was like so beautiful, but at the same time, really kind of, I wouldn't say, it was just like subjected to change because of natural forces that no person could have any control over, right? So like my father was a rancher and a farmer, and he would tell me these tales about how someone's livelihood could be wiped out in a single storm, and like kind of what that balance is like, you know, wanting to appreciate and love the natural environment, but also being at risk of it at all times. Mm-hmm. So that's what I focused on in art school. And then I had a friend who was volunteering in this campus zoological museum. She was doing specimen preparation and was posting these pictures of like what she was doing on her Facebook. And she was posting pictures of like, oh, today I just, you know, cleaned two wolf heads from Montana Fish, Wildlife and Parks and put them into a colony of flesh eating beetles. And I was like, my mind was just blown because, again, it's like blasé, like, oh, this is just what I did today on a Tuesday. And I was like, wait, this is the coolest thing I've ever heard of in my life.
You were like, I want to get to a point where flesh eating beetles becomes ho-hum.
Yeah. And so I was like, please take me to this place. And so she did. One afternoon, she brought me over to this zoological collection because I, even as a student on campus, I had never heard of this place. And it's because it doesn't have public exhibits. It's just a research collection. And as an artist walking into this space that had, you know, 20,000 specimens and all of these skulls of animals I didn't even know about, like, it, for real, I didn't know that the wolverine was an actual animal. Until I went into that collection, I thought it was just an X-Men character.
Oh, man.
So I was like, wait, hold up. Wolverines are actual animals? And they're like, yeah, they're like the largest weasel ever. And I was like, wait, you're blowing my mind right now. And so I just started going in there to draw from the specimens as a way to learn more about, you know, them and the natural world. And from there, just kind of became obsessed with the idea that there are collections like this all over the world that hold everything that we know about the natural world and natural environments in actual physical collections. And more than that, these collections are at risk. They're underfunded, they're underappreciated, and nobody really, you know, we're kind of in this like great technological age where you just assume we don't need those physical artifacts any longer. And so that's how I started to use my art to communicate. And so I was drawing the specimens and then photographing the specimens and then put all of this on a blog. And then eventually had the opportunity to start a YouTube channel and where I could just talk about them. And that's kind of how I got into this position.
So the YouTube channel, and this is the brain scoop that we're speaking of here. This began while you were working at this museum at your college.
Yeah. So I had started an internship my senior year, my last semester. Then I graduated and I was like, well, you know, my day job was selling textbooks in the campus bookstore. And I was like, this is not doing it for me. So I continued to volunteer in the museum and then got a job doing something else, but like just kept up with the volunteering and doing specimen preparation and documenting it. And then eventually had the chance to meet Hank Green, who, you know, is a professional geek. And he, you know, I kind of talked his ear off about this place. And for those who don't know, Hank Green is an internet entrepreneur and the host and co-creator of Vlogbrothers and Crash Course and SciShow and all of these tremendous, awesome, you know, that far-reaching science education channels on YouTube. And he just happened to live in Missoula, Montana. And so he and I kind of met up and I, again, talked his ear off about this place. And he came back one day with the camera and was like, well, let's film a tour.
So you were just put on the spot, huh? Like, give us a tour on camera?
Yeah, to be honest, I had no idea we were going to record that day. Like, I don't know how I misinterpreted the email, but he had come to the museum once before to use it as a background for an episode of Crash Course where they were talking about the vertebrate skeleton. And so I was like, wow, this is perfect because I have a vertebrate museum. And so, you know, I just kind of set the stage for them. But then, you know, later, a couple months later, he was like, well, I'd like to come back. And so I just assumed it would be for another Crash Course thing. And then I was talking to his camera guy, Michael, and I asked Michael, well, do you want a quick tour around this museum before Hank starts filming? And Hank was like, well, no, we're going to wait until we get you mic'd up. And I was like, wait, why do I need a microphone? And he was like, well, I thought you could give us a tour. And so that was kind of a moment where I was like, this was my Hamilton moment where I'm like, I'm not throwing away my shot.
Right.
So I was like, okay, well, I'm just going to do this the way that I always do these tours. And if it works out, great. And if it doesn't, I'm in no worse of a position anyway.
So you went from being this surprise guest on with, you know, Vlogbrothers to now becoming, you know, quite a bit of a YouTube influencer, especially in the science field. You've reached a fair amount of fame on that platform, which is, you know, a leading influencer platform on the internet and throughout the world. What has the experience like been going from, you know, that sort of surprise interview to now being a very public face, especially for an audience that's probably very young?
It's definitely been a roller coaster. I'd be lying if it wasn't. I mean, like, so I have this dream job. I have a job that never existed before. I have a job I could have never had aspired to. That's very surreal. And it is a roller coaster. There are definite high points where, like, you know, yesterday I was kind of having a crappy day. Things weren't going my way. I was having, like, you know, roadblocks just from a variety of different directions. Everybody has days like that. And I went to go check my mail and there was this envelope and from somebody I didn't know. And so I opened it up and it was this handwritten letter from a 13-year-old girl in California who I didn't know. And I opened it up and it was like a 2-page handwritten letter and like a 6-page typed essay for an AP English class in 9th grade. Oh. And the subject was that she had to pick somebody who was a beautiful person to write a 6-page essay on. And I just saw, like, held this thing in my hands and like kind of cried because the title was Emily Graslie, a beautiful person. And the whole thing, it was just this essay about how great she thought I was and like how inspiring. And so like those kind of moments are really, you know, it doesn't matter how many YouTube views we get. It doesn't matter if I'm influencing 1 or 100 or 100,000 people. It's those individual interactions that you have, knowing that like, I had a big impact on this girl who's going to grow up thinking that she can be a scientist and that her curiosity in the natural world is completely validated. I mean, that's why I do the work that I do.
Did you have a lot of social media experience before getting involved with, you know, producing The Brain Scoop and with Hank Green? Or were these sort of your first, you know, forays into kind of being a larger personality, you know, through these sort of social platforms?
Well, I wouldn't say it was my first experience with social media because I'd say I've always been a child of the internet. So like when my family got a dial-up connection when I was about 10 years old. And when you grow up in South Dakota as a total nerd, you have very few outlets for your nerddom. Like I remember when our Blockbuster got a copy of it was some anime. I'm blanking right now. It's not Tamagotchi. That's an actual digital thing. Anyway, Tenchi Muyo. So we got like a VHS set of Tenchi Muyo and I crapped my pants. I was so excited. So when we got like internet dial up, the first thing that I did was join a Sailor Moon chat room. And then I joined like a Dragon Ball Z and a Pokemon chat room. That was my level of anime that I had access to in South Dakota. But from a very young age, I was engaging in digital community, right? I was seeking out people who had similar shared interests as me and trying to find common ground. And I did that with every nerd and geek phase throughout my adolescence to the point where, you know, when I started my blog back in 2011, just talking about natural history and museum stuff, I didn't have a great expectation that it was going to be viewed by a lot of people because my sphere of influence like was very small anyway. I just did it because I wanted to find similar community, and it definitely dealing with, you know, 300 followers to a blog versus 300,000 is completely different. But I think I've always, like I said, been a citizen of the internet, and that's always just grown with me.
Yeah, I've always called that being like a digital native, because I have a similar, I totally understand, same age type and all that. So how did you go from, you know, creating this blog and then this YouTube channel that were increasingly creating fame to working with the Field Museum? Did they approach you? Did you approach them? What was, you know, what was the connection that led to this path that you're on now?
Yeah, so I approached them, but it was because of another thing. So I launched the Brain Scoop with Hank Green's help in January 2013, and I was working with a camera guy, the same camera guy who I offered to give a tour to, Michael Aranda. And Michael and I had been working on the show for, I want to say, like 2 months, like middle of maybe even a month and a half. But anyway, middle to late February that same year. And I got an email from a woman named Heather Hsu, and she was like, you know, I started watching your program because as soon as we launched the Brain Scoop, it was written up in all these like scientific pop science journals, like NPR featured us one day, and then Popular Science and Scientific American had these articles about this new YouTube science show about natural history museums. And so it got pretty popular pretty quick. And, you know, Hank and his brother John, their influence was huge too. But anyway, this woman, Heather, reached out to me and she said, you know, I really like your show, but I've been a longtime member of the Field Museum in Chicago, and every year in the spring, they do this awesome behind the scenes thing for members where people who are members in the museum can go behind the scenes, meet with curators, see the collections, and just learn more about the mission of the institution. And she said, I'd really like to pay for you to go to this so you can experience it. And this blew my mind. Like, number one, I didn't think anybody cared about our show enough to like want to fund me to go anywhere. And two, the fact that like she was just willing to send me on this trip was amazing. So I called the Field Museum's press office, their PR office, and I was like kind of intimidated, but I said, "Hi, you know, my name's Emily Graslie. I have a YouTube show in Montana about museums, and I had this chance to maybe come film this members nights thing I've heard of. Is this something that you would ever consider?" And the woman on the other line was like, "Can you please hold?" And so my immediate thought was like, oh, she's just going to like laugh and then pick up the phone and be like, "Ha, no." But a couple moments later, she picked up the phone. She was like, "Yeah, we've seen your show. Like, we're big fans here."
Whoa.
Yeah.
What a moment.
I know. I lost my mind. I was like sweating in my apartment in Montana. I was freaking out. And she was like, "Yeah, you know, I definitely think we can work something out." And so because of this generous offer from Heather Hsu, she flew us out, me and my camera guy, to Chicago. And like, I had to buy a smartphone because I'd never owned one before. And then all of a sudden I was like, "Oh my God, I don't even know how to get on a subway train. I don't, I'm from South Dakota. I barely know how, I'd never hailed a taxi before." And so it was like little girl going to the big city kind of thing. But she funded this trip, and we filmed, I think it was Wednesday and Thursday at the museum. And then someone had told me that Friday morning, all these people wanted to sit me down and talk to me about what I thought about this members night's experience. And I was like, "That's kind of weird. Like, why do all these like executive people want to hear about what some know-nothing thought about their big member event?" And so the long story short, I went into this conference room early on Friday morning, and they had this like great plate of cookies there. And I was so distracted by the cookies, but their mammals collection manager at the time, their director of collections, was like, "So we really like what you're doing with this program. And like, we really think it would be something cool for the Field Museum to do something like it." And I was like, "Oh yeah, you guys, like, you're a huge place. You'd have no problem." He kept kind of trying. He was like, "Well, I really just think we need like a really enthusiastic host who's like, you know, good at social media and stuff." And I was like, "Well, you got like Second City and like, arts colleges." And eventually, like, he was like, "No." And I kind of looked around, and all these people are staring at me around this conference table. And they were like, well, we kind of were hoping you might do it. And like, time just kind of stopped for me. I was just shocked. And I basically said yes on the spot. I was like, yes, can I start right now? I'll do this. And so that's kind of how I got my job.
Hmm. Yeah, I admire the fact that you drew it out of them asking you rather than being like, I'll do it.
It wasn't deliberate. I never thought in my wildest dreams that a place with such a great reputation as the Field Museum would want some yokel art student from nowhere, Montana, to come and represent their science. Like, it just didn't even register with me that was going to be a thing that would ever happen.
Now, as you have, you know, kind of gotten into this show, have you, you know, done studies on the side, you know, in various fields of the science? Like, I watched the parts of the wolf dissection video that my stomach allowed me to watch. And, you know, just watching you speak about this, you know, fairly complex procedure of, you know, skinning the wolf, you would think that I was watching, you know, a doctor with, you know, years and years of experience doing that, the way that you, you know, present the topics and, you know, and the subject of what you're doing as you're going through this process. How do you develop that knowledge and have it come across so nonchalantly, I guess, for lack of a better term?
Well, that's a great question. And I think that's really a testament to my art degree. You know, being an artist and going through a traditional studio art program, detail is your focus. You know, you have to be detail oriented. And you're always focusing on the small nuances of whatever it is you're looking at. And so that's the same for landscape painting. That's the same for scientific illustration. So when I started volunteering in the Zoological Museum in Montana, I was looking at these skulls of these animals, and I was spending a long time looking at these skulls. And so imagine the skull of, let's say, a wolverine. It's medium-ish size. You could hold it in the palm of your hand. This thing is going to be kind of oval shape, but it's got a big ridge on the back of its head, and it has these other processes off the back of the head. You know, like if you rub your dog's head, you can kind of feel that bump.
Mm-hmm.
It's called a sagittal crest, and it's large on carnivorous animals that need to have a strong bite force. So things that are going to be ripping and tearing flesh, they have a tall sagittal crest because that's where the muscles attach. And so when you're looking at these things and you're seeing like, wow, it has a lot of very sharp teeth. It must be, you know, it must use those to chew up meat. It has this big crest. Well, what's the big crest for? It has these huge eyes. Well, maybe it's semi-nocturnal. So you start to, you know, in evaluating that organism by drawing it, you're asking these questions that you never would have thought to have asked before without having spent a long time studying it. And so just extrapolate that experience to drawing the entire skeleton and looking at the entire body system. And that was really how I learned anatomy. So I had the chance then for a semester or two to be the TA for the vertebrate osteology course for graduate students, just because my art degree kind of set me up really nicely for being able to look at an organism and tell what distinguishing characteristics differentiated it from a similar organism.
Hmm.
So I spent a lot of time just studying anatomy that way for drawing. And that really helps me when I'm doing like a public presentation or doing an episode of the Brain Scoop. I can point to a muscle group, or I can point to a part of the skeletal anatomy and talk about the function of that bone.
Hmm. Did you have any acting or performance experience, you know, going into the Brain Scoop? Or?
Well, I was always in children's theater, like growing up. So I was privileged to do that. My first job was running a soundboard for a children's theater troupe in a free park in Rapid City, South Dakota. So, like, occasionally I would dress up in a ridiculous costume and do a 20-minute play throughout the summer. And I did drama club in high school, but by that time I was too awkward to get any really good roles. So mostly I just ran lights, but, that's about my acting experience.
As of this recording, your most recent episode was of camel spiders. sort of in the vein of Mark's last question, I just would, you know, I hate to put this out in the public, but I'm a huge arachnophobe, so that was very hard for me to get through. Has there been anything that has been personally challenging for you as with any of the episodes that you've been recording or any of the topics that you've been researching?
Well, yeah. I mean, I think all of them have certain challenges because I don't have a background in this. So anytime we do a video, it's going to be a learning opportunity for me. And that's kind of understandable. You know, I get that I have a vehicle for communication and I'm not expected to be the content expert. But in order for me to get that educational material across, I need to have a good understanding of the material. And a lot of that is self-taught. So I've had to like teach myself how to understand and read scientific papers. And that's hard. Like when I never took a biology class in college, I've got to all of a sudden teach myself theories of evolution. But it's easier because I work in a scientific institution. I have a lot of close friends who are scientists and evolutionary biologists. So I have a great network that I can just like email somebody or ask somebody a question and not feel like I sound like an idiot because I'm asking for clarification. But really the most challenging episodes are those that you know the audience needs to hear but maybe doesn't want to hear.
Mm.
So we've done videos that talk about inequality, gender inequality in sciences. We've talked about things like last February, we did a video about menstruation and field work because a large part of my audience is girls and women. And I know from personal experience and from talking with a lot of other scientists that things like bodily functions, especially menstruation, is never addressed when it comes to field work, but it's a big problem because it's a problem of hygiene and sanitation. And it's just unfair that there's a strong bias against talking about it in an open and frank kind of way. So to solve that, we did a video, but that also meant that like I had to go to my boss, my direct supervisor, who's the president of the field museum, and sit down with him with a list of like what episodes we were going to be doing in the next, you know, month or so, and be like, so we're going to do a video about water beetles, and we're going to do a video about camel spiders, and also I want to do a video about menstruation and field work, and then we're going to do a video about coyotes. So, I mean, that puts me in personally an awkward situation, but at the same time, this is like a goofy mantra my sisters have been living off of lately, which is there's no comfort in the growth zone and no growth in the comfort zone.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah. So I am all about like, you know, if I don't feel uncomfortable, I'm not challenging myself. And I just have embraced that.
So we were just, you know, talking about this topic, but you know, you have become a prominent woman in the STEM field. Albeit, you know, you have an art degree, you're still a prominent face in the STEM field. You're still working in STEM. You speak candidly about gender politics. You speak candidly about gender issues in the field. What has it been like navigating those topics on the web? And I don't mean that to ask that to invite any conversations about trolls or anything like that, but what has been your experience being an outspoken woman in the field?
It's the roller coaster thing. It has its ups and downs. You know, I'll have somebody write me a letter saying, you know, I'm in my 60s, I'm a retired librarian, I never thought I could be a scientist, but I always loved the natural world. I just never had a role model who made me think that I could do it. But the way that you talk about these things and these challenges candidly, you know, I'm just glad that you can do that for the next generation of women in STEM. I mean, so like, those are the things that I'm like, oh God, oh, like I need a tissue. But you know, there are trolls on the internet. This is 2017. I don't think that's a surprise to anybody.
Wait, what?
I know, right? There are people who are always going to take issue with women seeking equality, with people talking about racial injustice. I'm at the point where I've done this long enough and I understand like I have a platform and I have an obligation to use my privilege to advocate for people who aren't as privileged as I am. And I am totally okay with putting myself out there and taking the brunt of abuse from people. Because their comments aren't going to, they're not going to stop me from doing that.
How do you feel like we can, you know, intervene and move forward and get more women into the STEM field? I mean, obviously, you being a prominent face is a huge deal, as you brought up that letter that you received earlier this week. What are other ways that, you know, as a culture, we can intervene and get more women involved?
Well, representation is such a huge part of that. So when I first started doing YouTube videos, I was one of very, very few women on YouTube with a science or education channel, period. And that was actually one of the reasons that I wanted to put myself out there and try this. I thought, you know, I could be one of the first. And maybe if I do it, maybe there will be other people who will follow me who can say like, hey, you know, I see what she's trying to do, but I think I can do it better. Because like, I don't have an ego big enough to think that I'm doing this the best that anybody could do it ever. Like, that's not why I do this. I want to set an example that even as an art major, even as somebody with no video experience, I can make a positive difference in the world. And so I think advocating for an increasing diversity in these fields, that's really going to help them grow. I use this example all the time, but if you go to Google Images and you put in scientist and you go to look at what the pictures come up, they're all stock photos and they're all usually white people, usually white men in lab coats looking at colored fluids and beakers. It makes no sense at all. I don't work with a single scientist at the Field Museum who fits that stereotypical image. But it's not an algorithm's fault. That system has been made to think that that is who a scientist is. And it's by increasing the representation of scientists that you can change those kind of unconscious biases. And so I think promoting women and people of color in STEM, promoting those unsung or undersung voices, like that is how you move this needle forward. And I will continue to do that with the platform that I've helped to create.
Hmm. Now, I read, now you mentioned earlier in the conversation that, you know, you had grown up on a ranch, and I read an interview that you gave previously where you spoke about how, you know, that experience growing up on a ranch had actually sort of attracted you to the fields of science. But once you kind of got into high school, the way that science was taught kind of turned you off to that as a subject. How do you feel that, what could be done as far as the way that education is being presented in these sort of fields to, you know, kind of encourage a wider representation?
Well, I should correct you a little bit because I didn't exactly grow up on a ranch.
Oh, okay. I apologize.
No, that's fine. I grew up in Rapid City, South Dakota. My dad is in a long line of ranchers and farmers. He still has a ranch in Faith, South Dakota, and he farmland and everything. We spent a lot of summers and we visited a lot, but I spent most of my life living in Rapid City. But regardless, I always had easy access to the natural world, which is really where that initial wonder was kind of inspired. I mean, I remember one time in my parents' house in Rapid City, looking out the back door and seeing a bobcat wander down from the woods to come pee on our patio furniture and then go wander back away. And just being like amazed about that interaction, like what is happening right now? And then, you know, you're right. When you get to high school, there's less adventure. There's this idea that's kind of perpetuated that everything has been discovered in science. I don't think that the current public school standards or Common Core learning standards do a good job of inspiring kids to think that they can make a change or a difference. The way that I was kind of taught science was very much like, look at a diagram in a book and this is the anatomy of a flower and there's no context to it. You're like, why do I have to know this? For me, I really struggled with learning that way. I'm a really visual learner, and I learned by doing things hands-on, but we didn't have that opportunity in my school to do hands-on education. And so I think the way to really increase that representation and the way to increase people's interest, young people's interest in science, is to show them that it's a dynamic field where we know way less than what we know. You know, like there's going to be far more things to be discovered that no human alive can even fathom. And to show that there are opportunities for people to make a difference no matter their educational background. Like we have citizen science endeavors where you don't have to be a formally trained scientist to contribute to scientific data or studies. That artists have a role in science, that communicators and actors and statisticians, like people just from every walk of life can participate in increasing our understanding of the natural world. That is not the image that was painted for me. The image that was painted for me for what a scientist is that person in a white lab coat looking at a beaker of colored fluid inside.
Would you call yourself a nature geek? I kind of want to get into the geek conversation a little bit. Yeah. It sounds like you have a couple of other geek passions, but to bridge that gap, it sounds like you've brought up so many examples from your youth that you might be a little bit of a nature geek from birth.
I'm a huge nature geek. Yeah, I mean, there are pictures of me as a kid in diapers sitting in a puddle of mud holding worms and just looking super excited about it.
What are some of your other geeky passions outside of the natural world?
Oh my gosh. I don't even know. I kind of like fell out of the world of science fiction when I started to realize how cool like nonfiction was. And all of my geeky passions are probably super lame at this point, but like I was really into Battlestar Galactica season. That's probably my favorite TV series of all time. I most likely have watched the entire series like 10 or 12 times. I watch it every single year from the beginning. And I don't really know why. There's like not a great reason for it. I just love it.
There's a lot of science in that show.
There is a lot of science in that show.
It's awesome.
Yeah. I think I'm just like, I'm interested in it from an anthropological standpoint. Like, I love that they have all of these different vessels that represent different cultures and different planets and how they all interact with one another and how they problem solve and where their prejudices lie and where their biases are and maybe like trying to figure out where those come from. I don't know. It's like it's my geeky anthropological view at a science fiction community.
Well, sure. And then I guess when it all comes right down to it, you know, in the anthropological vein, spoiler alert for the last season of Battlestar Galactica.
From a decade ago.
But like that all, like from an anthropological sense, all of that stuff that they went through, like that ended up becoming what is us, so
yeah.
to speak.
Oh, crazy. I love that show so much, though. I don't know if I've really earned my geek cred. I used to consider myself far more of a geek in terms of like popular culture, popular media. But, you know, the last movie I saw in theaters was Wonder Woman. And that was the first movie I've seen in theaters in like 3 years.
Well, I think one of the big things that we're really passionate about here at Professional Geek is the idea that geek cred doesn't mean that you're like a pop culture nerd. it can mean that you are a nature nerd or an anthropology nerd or a word nerd. We've had all kind of religion nerd. We've had all kinds of different geeks and nerds on this show. So we love that you are so excited about science, even though it's that you don't have formal training in it. That is a really, really exciting opportunity to talk about that.
Good, because like my favorite thing to do is to go in my backyard and figure out what bugs are hanging out on my garage. Like there's just two hummingbirds that were kind of fighting in my backyard right before I started this podcast. And I was like, yeah, what's going on? I don't know what's happening between you two, but there's some like evolutionary strife right now. And I was just really into it.
I almost feel bad that we dragged you away from that.
It's okay. I think they figured it out.
One of the other things we're really passionate about here is what we call the transferable skills. The example that I use in every episode, and I'm sure our audience is tired of hearing, is that playing Dungeons and Dragons as a kid led to me being really good at resource management and really good at managing people and being able to get lots of different people to collaborate with different various skill sets. Do you have transferable skills from any of your geeky endeavors or from anything from your childhood that led to, or not even your childhood, your early adulthood, that you felt led to this career that aren't what somebody might suspect? Although I think you nailed it pretty well earlier when you're talking about being able to see muscle groups and things like that as being an artist. But are there other transferable skills that led to you being this, you know, YouTube personality?
Yeah, I really think it kind of came out of that like love of online community from a really young age. from like becoming involved in a Sailor Moon chat room to like deciding, oh, I should have my own like Sailor Moon fanfic page. So I'm going to learn HTML so that I can have like the cutest like Sailor Moon photos on my GeoCities website and like learning how to animate a cursor icon so that I could like have all the GeoCities cred, you know? So like, so I did all of that between the ages of like 10 and 13. And then when I was, you know, 14 or whatever, I got a MySpace account because that's what everybody did. And I had a live journal and I had a dead journal and I had all these other online blogs. And so, I mean, I've been doing this longer than I haven't been doing this. I mean, for the last like 18 years of my life, I have been an active participant in some kind of online community. I mean, even to the point where when I was in college, I had a diabetic cat named Mr. Howell, and he was diagnosed with diabetes after I adopted him. And I'm such a freaking cat lover. Like I didn't want to put him down because there was a chance that I could help him be better and to manage his diabetes if I just learned more about his illness. And so I went on to the diabetic cat forum and I became a participant and an active member for like a year and a half. And like was learned how to like document his insulin regulation and his blood sugar and like learned how to do all these like medical things so I could regulate my cat's diabetes. But like I just think really utilized the internet for its tools and its resources. And when it came to advocating for natural history museums and natural history collections, it was kind of like a no-brainer that I would do so online. Like I would try to find some kind of online community to help support what I was interested in doing. And I'm just glad that I'm a born of the generation that I could be a child of the internet.
Yeah, I find it very fascinating that like a recurring theme that I have definitely noticed as we've been doing this show is that fan fiction is an incredible gateway for people into like the nerdy universe. Like we have interviewed so many people when we get to this question, they're like, oh yeah, and I was also involved in, you know, I was involved in fan fiction. So I always find that really, really fascinating that like one thing kind of comes up repeatedly in our conversations with people, no matter the walk of life that they have found themselves ending up in.
Yeah. I definitely had a fan fiction phase. I wasn't writing it, but I was really reading the crap out of that, especially Harry Potter fan fiction.
So now, Emily, what is the weirdest thing that you've ever had to do professionally?
Oh, I'm probably like the champion of this question. You know, I do a lot of specimen preparation on our channel and as like a public event. Like just today, I prepared a mink for the research collection at the museum, and I did so in a public space at the Field Museum. But like I'm sitting here and my cats are obsessed with smelling my hands because I smell like anal secretions from a mink. This is probably good that I'm not in a studio with you guys right now because I am very smelly. But you know, probably one of the weirdest things I've ever done is in terms of preparation is that we got a dairy cow that was stillborn from a farm up in Wisconsin, and the thing had two faces.
Oof.
Yeah. So that's a two-part video series we did on the Brain Scoop a couple of years ago where like I prepared a calf that had two faces for a research collection and then put it into a colony of flesh-eating beetles.
Wow. That's pretty rad.
One of the weirder things I've done.
Why do you put them into colonies of flesh-eating beetles?
Oh, this is a thing that museums have been doing for years. Since, I don't know, 50s, 60s. Nobody really knows when it started, but there's a species of beetle that occurs naturally in North America. It's called the dermestid beetle, Dermestis maculicatus. And they're decomposers. So if you get a skeleton or a specimen that you skin and remove the organs, we have about 6 or 7 aquarium in a special room at the Field Museum that are just full with hundreds of thousands of these beetles and their larvae. And they eat all of the muscle tissue off of the bone. And so they do a much better job of cleaning the skeleton than we could manually trying to do it with our own tools and hands.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's
pretty cool.
That is really cool. What's been one of your more difficult or challenging professional accomplishments?
Oh, that's a good question. Probably the hardest project I've ever had to get off the ground was the crowdfunding campaign that we wrapped up in 2016. I wanted to do an Indiegogo campaign to raise money to build a brand new permanent habitat diorama at the Field Museum using some specimens that were collected in 1896 by the Field Museum's first taxidermist, Carl Akeley. And so I had this idea when I first started in 2013, kind of hatched with the director of exhibitions. His name is Yop. And it took about 2.5 years to get the idea off the ground, and then another year and a half to actually get the campaign up and running and then done and then the project executed. But we did it. And in 2016, we opened the first full-scale habitat diorama in 60 years to be built at the Field Museum. And we unveiled it in front of about 100 people who had donated from all over the world to this Indiegogo campaign. And they got to be the first people to see this diorama that you can still see today.
Wow. That's amazing. Congratulations.
Thanks. But it was just it was a really difficult project because we'd never done anything like it before. Nobody really knew how to do it. There was no proxy. It's like there's the question, well, how do you know you're going to get the money to do this diorama? And the answer was, we don't. You know, we just kind of have to trust in the enthusiasm of our nerdy internet community to make it happen. And they did it.
Now, what would you say you're the most proud of professionally?
Well, that's a good question, too. I'm proud of the fact that I feel like I've been able to change the way that people think about natural history, both as a field and as natural history museums. I get the impression that for a really long time, places like the Field Museum, places like any kind of natural history museum, they've been seen as kind of dusty storage spaces for old stuff that doesn't matter. And I think that I've had a pretty strong influence in this field to help people think otherwise and help them to see otherwise. I get a lot of letters from young people who are inspired to go into this field and to see how they can make a positive change. And I've also, kind of more surprisingly, heard from a lot of museums about how what I'm doing is helping them think about public engagement, helping them to think about, you know, how they share what they're doing or who even shares it. You know, maybe it doesn't have to be a top-down approach from the expert to the public, but maybe we need to be better about opening our doors to all kinds of people and have them share their experiences in our collections and in our research halls. And so that's something that's really intangible. It's like hard to quantify, but it exists. And I think that's what I'm proudest of.
You know, you actually touched on something that I had been wondering about. You mentioned your position with the Field Museum, the Chief Curiosity Correspondent. Now, have, you know, since you've kind of started doing this sort of stuff with the Field Museum, has that led to other museums kind of, you know, trying to find their own Emily?
Yeah, it actually has. So there's like I think it's the Arizona Science Center. I just had a call with them a couple of weeks ago, but they just kind of reevaluated a position they had on their staff to create the Vice President of Curiosity.
Oh.
And her job is a lot like my job. And so she kind of reached out and was like, well, do you have any advice for me as the new Vice President of Curiosity? There are a couple of like honorable positions, you know, people who their official title isn't Curiosity Correspondent, but I would say there's probably 6 or 7 people in museums around the United States who have some role of like curiosity correspondent.
Were you a little jealous that she got to be vice president of curiosity and you're chief of curiosity?
Well, you know, if I'm going to be honest, I think if I'm like chief officer, is that still above vice president? At the end of the day, I really don't care. Like, we're going to have an awesome conference the day that we can get a conference of curiosity correspondents together.
Wow. How amazing to sort of be creating a field.
Yeah. And I think it's really needed. You know, this is nothing new. Museums for a long time have struggled with how they remain relevant or how they approach the topic of relevance. And I just think that I'm really privileged to be coming up in a career at a time that technology allows us to reach audiences, not just in our local communities, but nationally and internationally at a way that like we never have been able to do before. So everything that's being created online now is a new thing. It's a new way of interacting. And there are so many possibilities that museums are kind of coming around to like, oh, how can I take advantage of that network? How can I reach out to people outside of our normal demographic? And what are the technological tools that are going to allow me to do so? And using the Brain Scoop as a model, as a platform for digital community, has been, I think, really inspiring for a lot of museums that before were a little more hesitant to do something like this.
Well, Emily, thank you so much for being on the show with us. This has been truly an amazing opportunity to speak with you about your career and how you've been able to, you know, become the forefront and beginner of your field.
This has been great. Thanks for having me.
How can our listeners follow you? How can they find the Brain Scoop, Field Museum, all those things?
Yeah, so you can find the Brain Scoop on YouTube. It's youtube.com/thebrainscoop, or just look up the Brain Scoop on the Googles. The best way to reach me is probably through Twitter. I'm pretty active on Twitter. My handle is EHMEE. And if you want to find out the other things that are happening at the Field Museum, just check out fieldmuseum.org.
Excellent. Yeah. Emily, thank you very much for taking the time to chat with us today. This has been really fun.
Awesome. Thank you.
This wraps up this episode of Professional Geek Podcast.
Before we go, I do want to mention a few things. You can download and subscribe to our podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, Player FM, SoundCloud, and Libsyn.
You can also hear all of our episodes and read extra content at our website, professionalgeekpodcast.com.
Please subscribe to the show and rate us.
Follow the show on Twitter at ProGeekPodcast and Mark and I at Mark Beers and at Blaire Loves TV. And remember, that's Blaire with an E.
You can also find us on Facebook and Instagram as Professional Geek Podcast.
Our audio producer is John Wong, who can be found on Twitter at SoundGuyJohn. And our recording studio is Periscope Post and Audio at Chicago CineSpace Lot, which can be found on Twitter as at Periscope PA. Our theme song was written by Daniel Capo. Want to be on the show or send us fan mail? Shoot us a note at info@professionalgeekpodcast.com.
Thank you again for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.